BASF. We create chemistry.
First of all, good morning, everybody. Thank you for dialing in. Welcome to our next edition of the BASF Agricultural Science Policy webinar series. At this stage, Joe, I think it's probably best to move on to the videos from our MEPs to set the scene. We're going to hear from Ulrike Müller, who's a German MEP since 2014. She's a member of the Renew Group in the European Parliament, a member of the Agriculture Committee, and a substitute on the Environment Committee. And for those of you who follow this debate, you'll realize that those are two of the key committees involved in policy making in this area. Mrs. Müller is also a farmer, a dairy farmer, and she was a member of the Bavarian Parliament, where she held a number of responsibilities, including being on a member of the Committee on Food, Agriculture and Forestry from 2008 to 2014. So very experienced practitioner in the area of agriculture and politician, than Mrs. Müller. That will be followed by a contribution by Ignacio Zoido Alvarez, who is a Spanish MEP, a member of the EPP, the European People's Party. He's also a member of the Agriculture Committee. He's held many offices, high offices in Spain. Just to mention two in particular, he was a member of the Spanish Congress and a Spanish Minister of the Interior and Home Affairs. So I think it would be very helpful now to hear from both of those MEPs.
Sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, liebe Teilnehmer, die Europäische Union will bis zum Jahr 2050 klimaneutral werden und in Zukunft schonender mit natürlichen Ressourcen umgehen. Beides ist für die Landwirtschaft eine große Herausforderung. Wir wollen, dass die Landwirtschaft zuverlässig ausreichende und bezahlbare Lebensmittel produziert, um in einer Welt mit steigender Bevölkerung Nahrungsmittelgarantie zu geben. Für den Klimaschutz gilt es, weniger Effizienz zu steigern. Weniger Düngemittel und weniger gefahrene Kilometer auf den Feldern bedeuten weniger Treibhausgase. Für den Umweltschutz müssen wir die Widerstandsfähigkeit der Ökosysteme stärken und den Eintrag von Schadstoffen reduzieren. Nicht alle denkbaren Maßnahmen kommen beiden Zielen zugute. Manche widersprechen sich sogar. Ein Feld mit großem Potenzial, sowohl für eine effizientere Landwirtschaft als auch für belastbare Ökosysteme, sind neue Variationen von Nutzpflanzen. Neue Züchtungstechnologien wie CRISPR-Cas bieten Chancen, hier wesentliche Fortschritte zu machen und so einen Beitrag zu den Nachhaltigkeitszielen zu leisten. Ich halte es deshalb für wichtig, offen zu sein, den Weg für Innovationen zu bereiten. Ihnen wünsche ich jetzt eine interessante und erfolgreiche Veranstaltung.
El mundo se enfrenta a un crecimiento demográfico acelerado. Y cada vez son más los millones de personas los que debemos alimentar. Además, como estamos comprometidos con la lucha contra el cambio climático, queremos hacerlo de manera más sostenible con menor impacto ambiental. Y todo ello pretendemos conseguirlo, por supuesto, con menores recursos financieros por parte de la Unión Europea. Pues bien, ¿cómo pretendemos conseguirlo? ¿Cómo pretendemos lograr la cuadratura del círculo? Como a estas alturas ya no creemos en la magia, tenemos que recurrir a la innovación, a la biotecnología, a la edición genética y a las new breeding techniques. Y además debemos estar convencidos de que la tecnología es la clave del futuro de Europa. Si la Unión Europea pretende competir en la carrera geopolítica con Estados Unidos y China, no podemos pretender que lo haga atada de pies y manos. Europa necesita más libertad para innovar y más innovación para prosperar.
Before I hand over to Nicola, it's a huge pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Nicola Patron. She is a researcher at the Erlen Institute, where she leads a group studying plant molecular and synthetic biology. It's an independent bioscience institute located in Norwich in the UK. Our research was established in 2016 and investigates the regulation of gene expression and metabolic diversification in plants. They apply this knowledge to engineering plants as photosynthetic platforms for biomanufacturing and to improving yield and nutritional value of crops. Nicola also co-directs the Earlham BioFoundry, a facility developing automated nanoscale workflows for biology and biotechnology. Nicola holds a PhD in plant molecular biology from Rothamsted and the University of East Anglia, a postdoctoral research from the John Innes Centre in the UK and the University of British Columbia. And as of 2015, Synthetic BioLeap Fellow, Nicola was recognised as an emerging leader in the area of synthetic biology. So we're very, very fortunate to have you here today to speak, Nicola. Thank you, a big thank you in advance, and we're looking forward to hearing what you have to say about making crops for the future.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Nicola.
Fantastic. So it's thanks, Paul, for the lovely introduction. I'm delighted to be here today. So today I'm going to talk to you about plants and particularly new biotechnologies and what they can be used for. So my aim in this talk is to give you an introduction to why we need to improve crops, how we've done this in the past, and what options are available to us now. So first of all, I'm just going to introduce myself. Actually, first thing, I'm just going to change my pointer. Okay. So as Paul said, I'm a plant molecular and synthetic biologist. So I realize that for lots of people, synthetic biology is a new term or they're not quite sure what it means. So basically, synthetic biology applies principles from engineering and computational mathematical modeling to biology and biotechnology. So while in the past, biology tended to need to make thousands of versions of something or to do lots of experiments, changing one thing at a time to understand how things work, in synthetic biology, we put lots of information into a model and we use statistics and formal standards to design experiments to help predict what will happen when something's changed. So obviously, synthetic biology approaches like these can be really powerful when applied to biotechnology. For example, if you want to engineer a cell culture to make more of a molecule that you use as a medicine, you need to design and test less versions too, because your prediction will tell you what you need to do. So what am I using this for in plants, and what does this have to do with crops or plants? So one of the things that we're trying to do in my lab is we understand about how the information about when genes should be switched on is by how much they should switch on is encoded in DNA. And we use that information to understand how even small changes in DNA sequence can make a difference to how plants convert information about how much nutrients are available into how much the plant should grow. So eventually, we hope we can use that information to understand the role of specific sequences and to predict how slightly different sequences that will then affect plant growth. So we also work on understanding how plants make the valuable products that are really important in medicine and industry. So in many cases, we have, you know, chemotherapies that are of plant origin, but the plant only make them in tiny, tiny amounts, meaning that the drugs are rare and expensive. If we can understand how the plants make them, we can program other plants to program that molecule in high quantities. So products already made in plants are already on the market. So Elysio is a treatment for Gaucher disease, which is made in carrot cells. In the Ebola outbreak, you might have heard about ZMAP. That was made in a wild relative of tobacco, which is exactly the same system that I use in my lab. And the company Medicago already has a plant-made influenza vaccine, and they currently have a COVID-19 vaccine in stage 2-3 trials. So today I'm going to talk about some of the technologies that are used to enable those types of work. But to do that, we're actually going to go back in time quite a long way, and we're going to go quite far from home. So this beautiful photograph is a World Heritage Site in southeastern Turkey, and I'm told that its name means the hill of the navel. So this site dates back over 11,000 years, and archaeologists argue that this may be the world's first temple, predating sites like Stonehenge in England by more than 6,000 years. So as a plant geneticist, what's fascinating about this area is in the remains of the surrounding prehistoric villages, evidence of the world's oldest domesticated strains of wheat have been found. So there wasn't a single birth of agriculture. There was obviously rice in China, sorghum in Africa, potatoes and maize in South America. But the domestication of animals and grains in this region started the age of Neolithic farming in Europe. So now it's possible for scientists to look at these grains, the grains found around this site, and understand how crops have changed from wild species into domesticated species into the modern varieties we have now. And that allows us to understand what the process of breeding does to the genomes of plants. Genomes is the genetic material of then that organism. So what's happened since the humans were using this site 11,000 years ago? So first of all, in the 500 generations since then, it sustained growth on the planet to almost a billion people. And then in the last eight generations, so just the last, just over 100 years or so, we've introduced modern breeding, industrialized farming, and fed an additional 6 million more people. And that's, you know, that's an incredible achievement. And a lot of that has been by improving yields. But at the same time, now at a point where agriculture uses 40% of land, 70% of fresh water, produces lots of greenhouse gases. And in the next one or two generations, we know that we need to feed another 2 or 3 billion people before we think world population will stabilize and perhaps start to fall again. And we need to we know that using more land, more water, more chemicals are not options. And we also need to address a changing climate. So some of these additional people are going to be fed by reducing food waste. I'm personally not optimistic about global politics, but I think it's possible that some might be fed by fairer distribution of what we grow. Some people will also be fed by if everybody eats less meat, which requires less inputs per calorie. However, even if that happens, because climate and weather patterns are changing and because some current farming practices are harmful to the environment, we still need to improve agriculture. And to do that, we need new and improved crops, so we use less land for farming. We need crops that are more resistant to diseases, use less water, need less fertilizer, and ideally are more nutritious. So let's look at what happens to crop genomes across this same scale. So over the same time scale, what was happening? So as we were breeding field, there were very significant changes. Probably the biggest changes happened thousands of years ago. So the obvious outcome of selecting a small number of the best performing individuals and then keep breeding them together for years and years and years means that the amount of genetic variation that you have within your breeding population is much lower. So a moment ago, we said we needed new crops that yield more, more resistant to disease, use less water. So if there are no genes or new gene variants for those traits that we need in our breeding populations, where do they come from? And how do we get them into these modern high-yielding varieties? So this is a picture of the International Rice Institute in the Philippines, and we have many of these gene banks. And in these gene banks, we collect lots of varieties. So one of the best things I think that we did as human beings when we were breeding is we traded seed all over the world. And then that seed was grown and used to improve varieties for locally adapted regions. And so we have lots of different variations. So these are lots of different packets of rice that are all have different pockets of genetic diversity. And what this allows scientists to do is to be able to compare how all of these different varieties grow, look at the differences in their genomes, and start to associate some of those different gene sequences to different traits that we use. And that's very useful, but it still doesn't help us know how to get those genes into our modern yielding varieties. We know that you can't just take a variety that's from a different region of the world and grow it where you want to. If it is adapted to made all the changes in its genome to adapt it to a short day, etc., then it's not going to be useful to you. And also that, you know, if you breed those together, it's going to be complicated. So a moment ago, I showed you this. I showed you that wild species have quite a lot of genetic variation, and then we lost quite a lot of that as soon as we went to domesticate. And as we move into modern varieties, we have even less. So what I'm going to do now is just move around these bubbles just to illustrate the problem. So we know that different versions of genes, and sometimes we know exactly the gene, sometimes we know that it's just a big chunk of DNA, exist in the breeding populations, maybe quite closely related to our plant, or maybe in a wild relative that's more distantly related to our plant. And we have our key crops here that have a small amount of genetic variation. And we want to bring that variation in. We also maybe have other genes in less related plants, maybe even things that aren't plants that are different versions of genes that might be useful. So breeding or sexual crossing is possible, but only sometimes. So if they're closely enough related, then you can cross those. But even if you do that, you're going to change a lot of the genome. The progeny seed is going to have lots of the genome from these other varieties that are probably not high yielding, and that seed is going to be entirely unsuitable for farming. So we call that negative linkage drag, and that's because some of the bad traits that we don't want are linked to some of the traits that we do want. And it takes many years of breeding and crossing to perfect a variety to get rid of the things that we don't want and keep the things that we do, maybe even decades to create a new variety in this method. So over the years, many modern technologies, DNA sequencing, use of genetic markers, which recognize specific DNA signatures, can be applied to track which pieces of DNA are present and which are absent. And they've helped, but they don't necessarily make it easier to move things from further away. So the two things to remember then about these kind of conventional, so-called conventional breeding techniques, is they make very large scale changes to the genome. So you're crossing things that are much more distantly related, and that results in a lot of change. And the second thing to remember is that it takes a lot of time to actually get a variety that's suitable for the field. So the second thing that happened in the 20th century was then mutation breeding. So first of all, we want to talk about what's a mutation. So a mutation just means it's a change, and it's a change away from what was there previously. And it's a natural process. It happens sometimes when cells divide, the replication machinery stops, DNA breaks, and it makes a mistake. DNA breaks for other reasons. It also breaks through UV light. Most of the time when DNA breaks, it heals itself perfectly, but sometimes it doesn't. So you can get a small addition, a small deletion, or sometimes they'll just slightly change around, so you get a few bases or a larger piece of DNA that change. So it's important to remember that mutations happen all the time in every generation. So about a year ago, there was a really nice study of a strawberry plants, and people sampled along the stolons of the strawberry in different plants that have just been made by this non-sexual propagation, the way that we keep strawberry plants. And they showed that the rate at which mutations accumulate in different places, so that you had, these plants, even though they were clonally propagated, they have this accumulation of mutations that they have that have just occurred naturally. And the same on trees. If you sequence DNA from different leaves, you're going to find very slightly different errors. So all of these mutations occur randomly with respect to whether their effects are useful. So what I mean is that the mutation itself is random. If it turns out to be useful, and it's in a cell that's going to give rise to the germline, the pollen, or the egg, then that mutation will be kept. It will become fixed in the population because it's useful. If it's not, then it tends to disappear over time. So mutations bring in new genetic variation. A new variation means new traits. So in the 20th century, people started using X-rays and chemical mutagens on seed. So it was first tried in the 1920s, and then it was quite commonly used by the 1960s and 70s. So there's a variety of spring barley that was mutagenized in what was then Czechoslovakia in 1965, and that made a variety that was 15 centimeters shorter than the parent cultivar and increased grain yield by 12%. There's also a variety of rice that was mutagenized in California in 1976, and this made shorter, high-yielding rice that was more responsive to fertilizer. So you needed to apply less fertilizer to get growth. And that mutation has bred into more than 20 varieties. So obviously they had no idea what changes they were making to the genome. They knew things were changing. They knew they were getting new traits that were useful. And that technology is still used. These days you can go and look and see what the changes are. So in that initial line that you mutagenize, you have lots of changes, hundreds of thousands of mutations. And again, you then enter a breeding process to keep the things that you don't want, maybe get rid of the mutation load and of the things you don't. But it takes quite a long time, but it can be useful. And the advantage of it is you don't need to know what the gene does. You can just screen by looking for useful traits. You don't have to have an understanding of the genetics to start. So here you could just say by changing a little insertion or deletion, then you might just get a slightly different version of that gene, and that increases the variation in your plant of interest. So in the 1980s, we had new techniques available to us called recombinant DNA technologies. So by the 1980s, these were already being used to turn microbes, bacterial cells, into factories to produce useful molecules. For example, the production of molecules used in medicines. And plant sciences also then began using this recombinant DNA technology. So it's important to note that we discovered the tools for inserting DNA into plants. We didn't invent them. So those tools, they evolved in nature to move DNA from bacteria to plant genomes. So this happens in nature. So, for example, there's a very clear signature in the sweet potato genome that shows that evidence of bacterial DNA is inserted by exactly the same tool that biotechnologists use to purposely transfer DNA into plants. And there are many other examples of natural gene transfer from unrelated organisms. So in legumes, there is an example of a gene called albumin-1, and that actually came from a very distantly related or non-related, really, parasitic plant called broomrape, and it transferred in a gene, and the legume then kept that gene because it allows it to store sulfur, and it's toxic to confers toxicity to insect herbivores. So when genes are transferred by a biotechnologist, that's what we call a genetically modified crop. And these have been planted since the 1990s when they first started coming onto the market. They've been planted now on just shy of 200 million hectares across 26 countries and imported into around 44 other countries. So one of the examples of the traits that were made using GM is the BT trait for insect resistance. So instead of needing to spray with pesticides, which will kill all the insects anywhere in and around the crop, whether they're eating the crop or not, this will only affect the insects that browse on the crop. So the use of those crops or the use of that technology, for example, in cotton has been shown to reduce the application of pesticides by up to 70%, resulting in a net increase in biodiversity in those growing regions. So GM is being developed for many other traits, including, you know, resistance to blight by moving in a gene from here, a very closely related, a wild potato, basically, into this population. This potato is resistant. The versions that we grow are not resistant. If you do this, these plants have been shown to then be resistant, and then they don't need to be sprayed the multiple times every year that they are with agrochemicals to kill the pathogen. So now we have a new tool for gene editing called gene editing or new breeding technology. So the most famous of these tools are from the CRISPR system, and the CRISPR system has become the most popular system basically because it's the easy to use. So the first thing about gene editing is that the mechanism is the same for mutation breeding. It breaks the DNA and then sometimes, and the plant heals that DNA then using its own machinery, which is sometimes inaccurate. So you'll sometimes result in small insertions, deletions, inversions, can be as small as just one base pair, one letter of the DNA code changing, can be larger depending on what you're trying to achieve and depending on which event at the end that you select for doing. But the result is the same, is that you have slightly different versions of that gene as you did before. So the second thing is that mutation, it's like mutation breeding and unlike GM in that there's no need to introduce any new DNA. So here we're just changing a few bases that already existed within the plant. So you can use it to introduce DNA, but you don't need to. And for most of the things that people are trying to do at the moment, they're not trying to introduce DNA. They're not introducing any new DNA into the plant. So the powerful thing about being able to mutate existing genes into these versions is that we can use all the knowledge that we have about what variations of genes do. So all that knowledge that we have from gene banks that this version of this gene is more useful than this version of this gene, we can apply these. We can collect multiple of those together into a single variety without introducing any of the negative genes. So this has given us a tool to do things that we couldn't do before. And it also, unlike chemical mutagenesis, X-ray mutagenesis, it doesn't make any excessive mutations in the background. There will be some new mutations in every generation. We already talked about the fact that there are always mutations accumulating in the background, just a few of them in every generation. And some of you may have heard talk of what are called off-target mutations by tools like CRISPR. So these off-target mutations, when we wanted to mutate a sequence such as this, and we wanted, for example, to mutate this gene, but there's a very, very similar sequence elsewhere in the genome, and so you may end up mutating this as well. So this is obviously really, really important for human therapies. We only have one body, we don't want another one. But in plants, it's not really quite the same. So the same as when you do a mutation experiment with chemicals, you apply that, you get lots of different plants, and you can check all the variants, and you only need choose the seeds that has the exact mutation that you want. Alternatively, you can just use normal breeding afterwards for just one round or two rounds, and you can cross that plant and you can select for those that have the mutations that you want and those that and don't have the others, don't have the mutations that you don't want. So it's a very quick way of accelerating what we have been able to do before, the breeding process, and it also allows us to use all the knowledge that we're accumulating from gene banks, from studying, and from plant science studying, how genes work, to be able to choose either the best combinations of genes or the best variants of different genes and put them into the same variety. So the first generation of products that we're seeing are doing things that have been achieved by mutation breeding. We're seeing hyaluronic oils, variations in starch. In our lab, we've been involved in changing a single gene involved in starch biosynthesis so that the structure of the starch is slightly different. It's healthier. That starch has a lower glycemic index. It's also being used to do things like reduce gluten, increase nutrition, and reduce the amount of chemicals that plants need to grow. So I'm going to finish here. I want to thank everybody in my group that I work with and all of my funding agencies that have supported my work. And I want to leave you with three things to remember. The first thing is that crop breeding, by all methods, aim to bring new traits, new genetic biodiversity into edible, high-yielding lines. The second thing is that random mutations occur in every generation. And the third thing is that genome editing technologies, they use mutations in exactly the same way as previous technologies by breaking DNA and introducing new genetic variation into those lines. And thank you. Thanks, Paul. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
So I'm not sure, what about the questions? Nicola, we're going to pick up the questions at this end and give them to you so you can concentrate on answering them. Whilst we're waiting for questions, I had a question for you, by the way, Nicola. Of all of the different NBT possibilities that you're aware of, which ones do you think could contribute most towards the challenges that we're facing and the European targets of the farm to fork are becoming more sustainable, more resilient in our agriculture? What would be your top picks in terms of technologies that through these technologies could contribute towards achieving those sustainability targets?
In terms of technologies, so I have to say, I tend to think about technologies really as being tools, and tools can be used for things that are really useful and sometimes not so useful. So definitely the most powerful of the technologies that we have at the moment is genome editing, and that's really, it's the ease of use, it's the ability to be able to look at multiple genes at the same time. So I think it's the most powerful, but I think the impact depends on what kind of traits we apply it to.
Okay, thank you for that. I've got an interesting question here. Are hybrids making it more complex to introduce new properties?
Not necessarily, no. So if you're introducing something new, then you introduce it into that different version of the plant that you have. When you make a hybrid, you just have that hybrid, and you don't propagate that as a hybrid. So you have that single variety then. But there's no reason that you can't have a useful mutation that you put in any of the parents that you use to make the hybrid, and then you make your hybrid and you still get your hybrid rigor and use that. So I don't see that as being a particular deficit. I think it's just a combinations of ways in which you use to make your final variety.
That's great. We have a question here. When we hear new technologies allow deletion of genes, how can this be beneficial if it's there? It should be for our reason.
So I believe the question is, how can deleting a gene result in a beneficial trait? So there's a few different ways that could be So one of them is, in plants, lots of people might not be aware that, unlike in us where we have acquired resistance to pathogens, you know, we're infected with something. And as we've all been very aware over the last year, all of us have learned, you become infected with something, you raise an antibody, you have this acquired resistance. In plants, resistance is genetic. So we have plants have genes that either confer resistance. They also have genes that confer susceptibility, and pathogens exploit those. They target those genes and they use them to invade. So one of the things you can do is you can delete a susceptibility gene. It may have absolutely no impact on the plant's ability to grow, at least in the farming environment that you're growing it in, but it completely disables the ability of the pathogen to be able to infect that crop. So I think that's a good example of how you can delete a gene. And one of the other things that we're seeing is, for example, lots of the proteins that accumulate in grains are alpha gliadins, gluten proteins. They're not necessarily, it doesn't need to be those proteins. It doesn't actually have, that doesn't need to be the protein that accumulates in the grain. And obviously lots of people have an allergy or an intolerance to gluten. So the possibility of deleting some of those genes so that they don't need to be there. So there are many different genes that you can either completely delete or just inactivate by putting one mutation in them so that they're no longer expressed, no longer turned on. And that can just change the products that are made very slightly and convert an advantage either nutritionally or in terms of disease resistance, yield, et cetera.
So we've got a nice question here. To which extent can these new techniques reduce food waste and improve shelf life in the supermarket?
So one of the studies that I know is being worked on to improve shelf life is to improve, for example, the chemical composition of the skin, for example, of tomatoes. So this means that less pathogens, so the rots and molds that invade those can't invade so easily. So this extends the shelf life. Also actually makes them more nutritious because that's actually a molecule that's really helpful for us. So you can use the same thing. You can, again, this is can be a deletion. You can stop production of something else, which it leads to an increase in this. So just a point mutation can lead to an increase in a chemical that is already naturally present in the skin of a fruit, and that will increase its shelf life, possibly also make it more nutritious.
Very good. Another topical one here. Can NBTs increase carbon sequestration in plants?
So I guess one of the ways that plants sequester carbon is by storing them in their roots and may not be so totally relevant for crop plants that we tend to harvest. And then obviously we'll use that carbon. But for other plants, carbon storage, then I guess making a larger and more complex and permanent root network that grows quickly and goes deeper into the soil is one of the ways that could be used to capture carbon. So one of the things that we're actually working on in our lab then is some of these root development traits. And there's many people around that are getting new knowledge of how plant roots grow. How do you make them grow deeper, wider? And what's the difference between, you know, plants that grow in mangroves and swamps and those that grow in the desert that are able to tap deeper water reserves? So I think it's a really obvious, easy solution. I wouldn't say that anybody knows the gene, and it's probably not a single gene, but there are avenues that could be explored that might help to find solutions.
Another nice question here. To which extent are these new techniques only being focused on the large crops like cereals and soybeans?
Well, I guess I don't actually think that they are only being focused on those large crops. I think one of the things about, I guess, all modern biotechnologies is that at the beginning, they're very expensive and they tend to be done by people that have a lot of money. And people that have at least the seed breeding companies that have a lot of money are concerned with making crops that are grown a lot. So what we're seeing is that some of the very large companies are obviously investing in the crops that make them money. But there are many projects that are going on in smaller, you know, in smaller labs and smaller companies on tomatoes and on lettuce and many smaller crops as well. So I wouldn't say that they're limited. I would certainly say that some crops are more visible than others in the media.
Okay. Two related questions, if I may. First of all, how competitive is European research in this field compared with the US and China? And secondly, to which extent does the ECJ ruling on novel seed breeding impact funding for academics in this area?
I think it's a difficult question to answer, partly because things change so quickly. At this very moment in time, I don't think there's very much difference in how advanced our capabilities in science are. We have the same ability to use these tools and techniques. We're using them as much. We are publishing as many academic papers. What is definitely true, and this is probably a consequence of the European Court of Justice ruling, is that our ability to move from our initial proof of concept studies and move into crops and start really working on things that are going to make it, you know, really testing those, get into the expensive research of testing them at large scale, breeding big populations. Those experiments, you know, they take more time, they take more money. And no one wants to invest in that kind of research and pushing it forward unless they really are going to have an impact. So at the proof of concept stage, I think Europe is equally as competitive. At the applied stage of moving things into the field, showing that they work, of course, we're less competitive because we don't have the investment to be able to do those things. So there is a really, I feel like there's a danger this could tip on a pivot point any time if you take away the promise of being able to move those things forward, then no one will want to fund the early stage research, and then we lose that expertise. And then the younger people that I guess we're going to hear from that are interested in doing these things, they just go and work somewhere with someone that will give them a job that they can use the expertise that we've trained them with.
Introducing a new modified breed into the environment threaten existing plants. Sorry if this is rather a simplistic question, but I often hear of concern in the population that existing biodiversity is threatened by GMO or GE plants.
So the question is, I guess, what's the impact of us growing crops of one particular diversity in the field outside, and whether that impacts on the wider biodiversity? So not really. Not more than, for example, the way that in my talk we talked about that some of the varieties we grow are not very diverse, and that's actually really important. So one of the things that varies a lot as soon as you have genetic diversity in plants is that you have plants flowering at different times. It would obviously be a disaster for a farmer if all of their grain in their field flowered at a different time, because you wouldn't be able to harvest it all. So there's lots of advantages for having genetic diversity. But even if some of that pollen escapes and breeds outside, because all of those populations are breeding within itself, it doesn't mean that it reduces the overall biodiversity, or even particularly that it becomes dominant. I think the only way that it would become dominant is if you were growing something that was very invasive and weedy. But our crops tend not to be very invasive and weedy. If they were, I guess we wouldn't need to spend so much time and energy cultivating them. It's the other things outside that are invasive. So, not really. It's very difficult to drive a decrease in biodiversity. The biggest impact that agriculture has on biodiversity is removing land that's currently forest, grasslands, whatever, and turning it into farmland. So the more that we can increase the yield on the land that we currently farm, the better our biodiversity will be. And ideally, if we can remove some of the land that's currently used for not very productive farming and turn that back into biodiverse land, that's much more likely to increase biodiversity. And there's really not any credible risk that I know of crops inside agriculture converting the biodiversity outside of agriculture to reduce that biodiversity at all.
Another question here. There are numerous benefits when it comes to gene editing and GMOs, yet consumers in the EU are very much against products produced using these technologies. How do you think we can change consumers' minds regarding gene editing?
I'm actually not entirely convinced that all of the consumers are particularly against either GMOs or GM. So there's various institutions that do quite a lot of research, the social scientists that work on this. And what they find is there's a very small proportion of people that are very pro biotechnology in general, or they're just pro technologists. You know, these are the people that always have the latest version of everything the day it comes out. There's a very small number of people that have they have ethical convictions, be they religious or for other reasons, that they don't think this is correct. And so there's kind of like these 10% of people at either end that are very for or very against. And there's the majority of people in the middle that when you talk to them, they're interested in safe food, they're interested in biodiversity, sustainable farming, and they're open to have the discussion. I think our media amplifies both ends very, very unequally to the majority of people. And from my experience of doing public outreach and to speaking to, you know, regular audience outside in the street, or when I do public talks to people, in that neither of these two groups of people are particularly in the majority. I think most people want more information. Part of the reason that I'm here today, I think it's really important that we are honest and open. We give people information. We give them options. We're open to take all of their concerns, even those that may be unreasonable, very seriously, and answer them, listen to them, and talk to them about what they want to know.
Thank you. So here's another nice question. Can we use NBTs to improve the productivity of organic farming?
Yes, is the short answer. Organic farming is crops that are farmed without the addition of chemical pesticides, fertilizers, and that means that you are increasingly reliant on the genotype of the plant that you're planting to be able to be high yielding. So it therefore follows that if you have a plant that is more naturally resistant to crops, or maybe you don't like the word naturally, but it's within its own genome perhaps to be resistant to pesticides, then you don't need to apply pesticides, then you can grow that plant using organic farming ethos, technology.
Interesting. So with a view to future regulation of NBTs, is it possible to differentiate between tools that allow gene transfer and gene editing, given that public view on classical GMOs in the EU is rather sceptical?
Okay, so it's very difficult to distinguishing between tools. Obviously requires the information of what tools were used. It's very easy to distinguish whether a gene was added or not, but how different that gene would be from anything that was there in the population is a different thing. So I have to say, I find the whole idea of having to regulate according to what the tool was used is incredibly difficult, because then I have something that's completely identical, genetically identical, that was made using chemical mutagenesis or made using a breeding technology, and then you're asking those to be regulated in slightly different ways, which is very obviously very complicated. But I think what you're actually asking is, can we make a regulation for new breeding technologies that says whether a plant has a mutation, or says whether these genome editing tools have been able to use to insert something? And I think, yes, we can, because I think you can distinguish on it from insertion from mutation quite easily. And I think there's probably another layer to that by whether what you've inserted, how different it is from anything that existed previously or not, and whether that matters or not is a different conversation. But yes, I do think it's possible to distinguish the two.
So if the USA is a leader in NBTs, and if China is allowed to play with CRISPR on babies, what role can we play as Europeans? Isn't it just too late to jump on the innovation train, big time?
I'm not sure that I would necessarily agree that America is any further ahead, or the United States are any further ahead, particularly than anyone else in the use of the technology. I think the main difference is the patent, particularly for its use in humans and human therapies. But I don't, the difference of where it was first used from one place or another is not very different. And as we know, Emmanuel Charpentier, who's a European, is the co-inventor on the Nobel for the invention of the technology. So I don't think I buy the argument that America is ahead. I wouldn't also necessarily say that China is using it to edit babies, because that implies somehow that it's state-sponsored. And in fact, the Chinese state heavily condemned the scientist that was involved in that. So I think that's an individual. I think it's unfortunate for China that that person was from China. I think it possibly maybe was not quite as likely to have happened anywhere. And China probably are very aware of that and are thinking about that. But I think it could have happened anywhere. So, no, I don't think it's too late by any means. I don't think I wouldn't really accept the position that we're behind. I think we have plenty of expertise and experience and centres of excellence in plant breeding within Europe that are willing, able, ready to use these technologies.
So I have a fairly lengthy statement here. It's not really a question, but you might want to comment on it. And I will read what it says. The statement that the 2018 ECJ ruling means that all genome organisms are GMOs is often heard assumption, but it is an assumption. It's not what the ECJ ruling says. The ruling was about the scope of the mutagenesis exemption, not about the scope of the GMO definition. Further clarification is therefore still needed as to which genome edited organisms fall under the GMO definition and which do not. And the study the Council requested from the Commission is a good opportunity for that. For an in-depth analysis of the ECJ ruling and the GMO definition, see the mid-December issue of the peer review law journal, European Journal of Risk Regulation. An advance untested copy is placed on the SSRN. I don't know if you would like to respond to that.
No, so I think maybe for everyone else that's not quite up to date with the intricacies of the ECJ ruling, and I wouldn't by any means expect to be an expert. I'm definitely a technologist rather than an expert in policy. But I think as we understand it, it was an expected result given that the definitions of GMOs are around the uses of recombinant DNA. But it doesn't necessarily define everything about this, and there's certainly more discussion to be had about the interpretation of this ruling. And that sounds like an excellent resource for anyone that is more interested in the details of the policy.
Thanks for that. There's a nice note here saying thank you for the talk. There is a lot of discussion on how to share the benefits of genetic sequencing from developing countries. What is the academic point of view?
Well, firstly, let me say let me loathe to speak for all of academia. I don't think I possibly could. We sometimes all agree, but occasionally we don't. So there are a few complicating issues, certainly for the use of our global genetic resources. So right at the beginning of my talk, you'd have noticed that I said that agriculture started in different places for different crops. And like everything, like every species on the planet, something has a home somewhere, it evolved somewhere. But most of the plants that we use for food have been traded all around the world for many thousands of years. And many individual countries and regions therefore have a claim to some of those particularly useful sequences that give rise to the traits that are interesting. So one of the things that's very difficult that I think that we have to grapple with as all of us, as a global population of people, is how to provide the benefits of the use of some of those genome sequences back to those people, while also understanding that we're not maybe specifically using those sequences, because the value is for science is in comparing all of those sequences together so that we can understand which genes confer a trait and which don't. So we need to encourage everybody to share what they have, because that's how we link a genotype to a specific trait. But we also need to get a mechanism to reward people for doing so. And I don't actually think that there's a simple answer. I think the academic answer is that it's a complicated sociological question that isn't going to be answered by technology. And I don't think it would be correct for me to say what the right way to do that is.
So one of the One of the audiences actually responded to your earlier statement by saying that you started your intervention by saying that you have little faith in politics. Any suggestions for politicians and policymakers? How can they do better and support scientific innovation?
I think probably all scientists would like to see a little bit more evidence-based policymaking. And obviously quite pertinent here where the overwhelming scientific opinion, as it is for climate change, is that we should have action, we should do something. The overwhelming scientific opinion for GMOs and genome editing is that they're, not only are they safe, but they're useful. They're going to make crops healthier. They're going to make them more sustainable. They're going to improve our environment. I think as a scientist, I think we would like politicians to pay more attention to us, as most groups would like politicians to pay more attention to us. I do also acknowledge that politicians have got, they don't only have to listen to one group, and they have to make difficult decisions that that balance what everybody needs together. But I think discarding evidence entirely is not particularly helpful.
Okay. So a strong call for science-based policymaking. Here's an interesting point. Are you concerned with the recent wave of biohackers or individuals that use gene techniques recklessly? Could they ruin the prestige of scientists further erode people's trust in this area of science?
I feel two things about biohackers. So one of the things I feel is that it's encouraging to see people interested in biology that didn't necessarily have the privileges and advantages of an education, for example, is the good that I had. And there are lots of biohackers that are not doing reckless things. They're working in community groups, and they're essentially, you know, in the same way that you might, I don't know if every country has like make spaces where people go how to learn to go how to use 3D printers, these kind of technologies. I think having spaces where people can go to understand how genetics works, what things people do with them, these also fall under this biohacking umbrella. I fully support this. I think people should be allowed to continue to extend their education and to learn how to do things and to understand how things work. I think this is part of being open about what technologies do and allowing people to understand. I think there's a difference in risk when people are doing things that are dangerous. I certainly think when people start injecting themselves with it or injecting other people with it or selling it, then this is dangerous. But this comes under laws that we already have, you know, impersonating a doctor, illegal sale of technologies, infringing IP, all of these things. To a certain extent, these are covered by our existing laws. I do acknowledge that there is a danger for someone obviously to hurt somebody, I think, but I'm less worried about them actually editing someone else's genome than I am about someone using something unclean and just infecting them with a pathogen that exists, which is far more likely. So yes, I do think we need to have regulations that say when people can use things and what people can use them for, but I would not say that I'm in support of banning all access to everything, because I think it's important that people, we're open with what we do, and I'm very supportive of educating people and people learning and, you know, entering biotechnology at different life stages, not necessarily through a university or research institution. I don't think anything has to be like that for this technology when it isn't for others.
Question. With a view to future regulation of NBTs, is it possible to differentiate between tools that allow gene transfer and gene editing, given that the public view on the classical GMOs in the EU is rather sceptical?
Oh, I thought we had that question, actually.
Oh, I beg your pardon. Okay, I beg your pardon. I jumped the lines. Okay, I understand NBTs can be useful in agri and health, like vaccines. Any other interesting applications?
Other than agri and health, I'm sure there are, but I cannot immediately think of one off the top of my head. And I feel like I'm one of these plant scientists, but I always think of plants. I see green first, and I really struggle to think of things further away. I guess one of the answers would be biomanufacturing. So manufacturing of new materials, new products. So we saw in the quiz thing that microorganisms have been used to make insulin. We're also seeing now microorganisms being able to make for example, have the genes from spiders to make spider silk, and that's being used to make new clothing, new high-performance materials. So I guess that kind of manufacturing, whether that's materials, whether that's drugs, whether that's new molecules that we use in fragrances, those kind of things, it could also be applied there. So I guess all of manufacturing has the potential to benefit as well.
Okay, I've got one final question. So if anybody has any further questions, now's your last chance, but I'll ask a very simple question, which is, are we equipped to assess the safety of these techniques?
Again, with techniques, I think we're conflating two things when we say techniques. We've got the safety of the tools, but the tools are natural. They're mostly discovered. It's how we use them. So what we're asking is, are we equipped to assess the safety of the products of the use of these techniques, not of the techniques themselves? In that case, I don't think it's appropriate for me to say as a technologist, I can give advice to people on how that technology works. That's a question that's best put towards our regulatory agencies. Those regulatory agencies, including in Europe, are coming with scientific opinions. We've seen those for the use of new breeding technologies come out from the European Commission within the last week. And it seems to be the decision of those regulatory agencies would seem to be that the processes that we have in place are fit for use. However, they're not always applicable because they were often, they were devised, for example, for assessing the safety of an inserted gene. And if there isn't one, then obviously then you don't really need to apply that part of the regulation or the regulatory process to do that. But otherwise, as far as I'm aware from regulators, there haven't been any particular flags raised, but I would say that I'm not a regulator. That's not my job.
Very wise. So we have the last two questions here, then I think we close the Q&A. But what suggestions would you have for young plant scientists that want a career in science to go to US or to stay in the EU?
Oh, well, that's a hard question. I think as an individual, you should always do what you think is going to give you the greatest benefit. And if you're an individual plant scientist, I think you should always work on the thing that you feel most passionate about, that you think is going to allow you to make the greatest contribution to the world. Hopefully that you'll be able to do that in exactly the country that you want to live in. And for some of you, that will be the US for some time, maybe not for your entire life, and for others that it won't. It's always a difficult balance, but I would always encourage people to follow their dreams and to work on the thing that they want to work on. And if you have to move for a little while, then sometimes, a lot of time, it's worth doing that. It can be a personal growth experience.
And this is another forward-looking and final question, which is, we look at today's technologies, but... my screen's just jumped. We look at today's technologies, but we fail to see what the future will bring. What do you see is the next technology in the making?
Oh, wow. I mean, if I knew that, I guess I could invent it already and become rich. I don't know what the next technology that will be. We know that the pace of scientific research and innovation is very fast, and it's very difficult to be able to see that. I would imagine that what we're going to see in the immediate kind of 0 to 5 year timeline is we're going to get a greater understanding, not just of how DNA sequence is important, but in the modifications to the DNA. Sometimes there's chemical changes on the specific groups of DNA that affect how genes are expressed. We'll have a greater understanding of those and a greater ability to be able to alter those, so we don't actually change the genetic makeup of the DNA, but just make very subtle changes around that. And I think those tools are probably going to increase quite quickly within the next few years. There's a lot of interest in that area, but I'm perfectly prepared to be wrong.
So as I said, it would be our last question. Another one popped up, so I think we'll extend it by one more question, which is, if gene editing is not facilitated and applied in agriculture moving forward, what are the prospects for achieving sustainability objectives and to feed the growing population? And then after that, I believe we will come to the opinion of our young scientists.
So I guess the overall question is, what are we going to do if we don't use new technologies? Well, the question is, what are we going to do in Europe if we don't use them? And I expect the answer will be is exactly the same as it is for GM, is that other people will grow them and we will buy them. And I'm not quite sure if that's the best answer, but I'm pretty sure that's what will happen. We'll import them as we do for GM products.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for all your many answers. You answered the questions extremely well. Now is a chance. I think Andrea is going to bring on a short video by a group of young and passionate scientists who represent an organization called Gene Sprout. I don't want to say too much about them other than the fact that I think it's entirely appropriate at this stage in the day that we seek an opinion and hear from the young scientists who are facing exactly those questions about where's their future and how the technologies that they're now studying can contribute towards these big challenges.
Hello, everyone. We are the Gene Sprout Initiative. In 2018, the ECG ruling made the use of genome-edited plants in Europe highly restricted. We felt that the ruling happened before any substantial public debate, and our voice as young researchers was missing. We founded the Gene Sprout Initiative as a communication platform to promote open dialogue with the general public and to voice our opinions about the tremendous value of genome editing and the negative impact that not using it will have on our planet and our future as the next generation of plant scientists.
Whether we adopt genome editing in agriculture or not, delaying the decision will only cause Europe to lag behind in scientific innovation and trade. But there's also a more personal cost to the ECG ruling. Here in the Netherlands, us scientists work closely together with breeding companies that fund our project. Back in 2018, the ruling was interpreted to mean that genome editing would result in GMO plants and be subjected to GMO regulations. This led to several companies pulling out funding from innovative projects, and many young, passionate researchers saw their dreams go up in smoke.
As young plant scientists, we find great satisfaction in the hope that we can, someday, polarize our research to protect food security, fight climate change, and foster biodiversity. But the current socio-political scenario around genome editing and the lack of opportunities to apply our knowledge causes us great frustration. This will undermine the motivation of many to pursue the career of a plant scientist and may take their talent out of Europe.
Threats like global warming and a growing population have made sustainable development the need for the hour. We see that plant diseases that were once confined to warmer regions are now spreading to more temperate regions. We strongly believe that the adoption of genome-edited plants, along with sustainable agriculture practices, can help fight climate change. If we decide to use genome-edited plants as our last resort, it might turn out that we are too late. If we want to be ready for the future, we need to start preparing right now.
We want to empower people with the correct information so that they can develop an informed opinion on plant genome editing. We hope that our work as researchers and science communicators will have a very positive impact.
Discussion. I'd like to say a big thank you to our MEPs, Mrs. Muller and Mr. Zoido Alvarez, for their contributions. A big thank you to everybody who's taken the time to dial in today. We really appreciate your active participation, and especially for all of those of you who took the time to ask questions. I thought were some excellent questions and some equally excellent answers. We will be sharing a copy of this webinar via our landing page, where you can find copies of previous agricultural science policy webinars and associated materials. And as I mentioned earlier on, Nicola's very kindly offered to answer any bilateral questions you have, and you'll be able to find her contact details on the landing page as well. I think I'm right in saying that at the end of that, I will draw this to a close. Thank you very much to my colleagues, Yuna Saidi, who did a tremendous job organizing this, and Andrea Boccuni, who's been behind the scenes making sure the technology works. It's been a real pleasure. A big thank you for us all, Nicola, for your very valuable contribution. And we look forward to hearing from you all when we do, if you're interested, that is, when we do our next webinar, which will be on labeling food for security And that will either be on the 27th or 28th of January, and we'll keep you informed of that one as it comes along. So thank you all. Have a very good day, and we won't see you before Christmas, so happy Christmas as well. Bye.
BASF. We create chemistry.